week six, we're wrapping up Drifters. I told y'all last week, if I'd have known I had to preach what I preached last week and this week, I wouldn't have even started this wreck. Because this last week and this week's wore me out. I'll tell you right now, I'm so thankful that I've got through it. That song Amy sang. Last week and the week before, I was probably struggling as hard as I've struggled all year in the preparations of a message and trying to find the boundaries. And I'm going to tell y'all, this whole series has been under attack from the get-go. I mean, there's been good and bad and fair and unfair. And, you know, there's been not just from me, but from y'all. I've gotten a lot of text messages or some of y'all have posted some things that are where you've been and where you see God and he's revealed things. And some of them, you know, sometimes when you get something revealed, you like it and you're happy it got revealed. Then sometimes you go, I wish that sucker would have never showed up. So there's been a bunch of that this last 6 weeks. And I'm going to tell you something. I'm so glad I got to this series, this part, because it is so allowed me to realize that I ain't in control. It really has helped me. And my wife made a statement. I'm not going to say it right, but you're going to have to help me. Was visiting with somebody, and she said, you know, it takes faith whenever you get faced with something in this life, in this world, that you know you can't do anything about. It takes faith to turn that over to the Lord and say, I just trust you, right? It takes even bigger faith when you think you could do something about it, and you turn it over and let him do it anyway. That's what this message is about. So, this word, this drifter, is called Nabal. That's the original language. It means wicked, foolishly, evil intent, mean. I studying and figuring out what animal this related to in my life, and I thought, first thing I thought of was snakes, because I can't stand them. I've had nightmares of snakes since I was a little bitty kid. I'm telling you, I'm deathly afraid of snakes. And I'm telling you now, if you think it's cool and you bring me a plastic one, I will hit you. I don't like them. I'm scared to death of them. But as I was reading and studying and you know, chewing on it, man, it brought me back to memories. And I love it when the Lord does this for me. And I'm like, that's exactly who he's talking about. And I can remember, I'm going to share two stories with you guys. And when we were kids, and it kind of happened at Christie's great uncle's funeral. We was in Jacksonville at his funeral, and an old man works at the funeral home, and I pointed him out to Christie, Mr. Charles Dickerson, as we come around that curve, and he's old man, old cowboy wearing a silver belly gray hat. I said, I really would like to introduce you to that old man right there. And anyway, I got her seated with her family, and I left them and went and visited with Mr. Charles. Mr. Charles, as soon as I walked up, he said, boy, how you been? And he just gave me a big old hug. And he said, come here, I want to introduce you. And this is how he introduced me. He said, this is Jason Taylor, boy. This boy right here, let me tell you about this boy. I sat many a day in a corn crib rack underneath in a feed trough watching this boy and his brothers get on all kinds of horses. His daddy would put this boy on anything, and them kids wasn't scared. I'm telling you, this was a little bitty feller. And of course, I'm just swelling up, you know. That's right. And you know, and he's just one of the, he's like that uncle that you love to look forward to seeing, because he don't remember none of this. He never mentioned all the times I got bucked off. He never, you know what I'm saying? He said, man, he's pastoring over at the Bar None Cowboy Church over there. It is the greatest, it is the best church going. It's awesome. I mean, he's just going, and I'm just soaking it up. I'm telling you, I'm like, man, we need to come have funerals in Jacksonville more often, you know. But it kind of triggered my thoughts. And you know how sometimes things will come back into you, you know. And I was studying on this deal on Nabal and how, what is a Nabal and how, what makes them some of guns like they are. And I remember two stories that I'm going to share them with you. And one of them, we ain't been in this country long. I was pretty little, probably 11 or 12, maybe 11. And we were riding a lot of horses. And Dale always had three or four outside horses. And we'd always have two or three Dale was riding and two or three that I was riding, and Dale'd get the buck in the rough off of them, and I'd just get them where they'd take anything. And Daddy was always trading horses. That's how we lived, you know. And somebody called Daddy, and I just remember it was somewhere right around Henderson. We drove out, and Dale had his saddle in the truck, and we was going to ride this bronc for this guy. And we got out, and me and Dale's getting stuff out of the back of the truck, and we're walking up to this barn, and we as we approach the pen, you know, it's big old pretty black horse in that pen. And Daddy looks in that pen, turns around that man, he looks at Dale, and he says, put your stuff back up. He said, we ain't getting on that horse. And head for the pickup. Now, I've been around 10 years, 11 years, I ain't never heard him say we wouldn't do something. I mean, never. And I'm like, I thought the guy done something really wrong. We're heading back to pick him. This guy that owned the horse gets plumb mad. And then, of course, my dad is very reactionary. We ain't got the pickup good. He's plumb mad. And I hear Daddy say again, bring me that saddle. Well, we just turn right back around. And I'm carrying a hackamore and a blanket, and Dale's carrying his saddle, and we're walking right back up there. And Daddy said, mister, if my boy gets hurt in any way, I will whoop you with some adjectives in there, up and down, all around. That man kind of stood there a minute, and he said, go on, put your stuff back in the pickup. I never really knew. It just, you know, I mean, I don't know. Yes, sir. I'm one of them. I don't care. Get on, don't get on. Get bucked off, don't. I don't. Probably the next year or two, we was real good friends with our neighbor. His name was Thomas Jay, and I always called him Uncle Jay. He lived actually right beside Christy. We were 11, 12 years old, and we'd go over there. Anytime Thomas traded for a horse, we'd go over there, and us boys would ride him. They'll be riding horses. I'd be checking out Christy over the fence, you know. Thomas would be saying, you better get your eyes off her. Her daddy's mean. He'll shoot you now. You better get your head back over here. There's just one day we go over there, and he had this gray mare he had just traded for. And we saddled that gray mare. She stood. She was pretty. She was supposed to be high bred, but he got her at a good deal. I mean, Dale stepped up on her. Some of y'all been there. Dale stepped up on her, and she walked out. I mean, she took, you know, she started easing, walking out, and all of a sudden that sucker went to bucking. And she could buck a little, you know. Dale could ride a horse pretty good, and he never bobbled. You know, he's just riding the hair off of her. She hits about, you know, half, I can't remember. She bucked a pretty good bit, and I remember thinking, she ain't going to get this done. And that song on stop bucking, reared straight up, walked about six steps on her back feet, and fell all the way over. Bam! Smashed him pretty good. Hurt him. I mean, it hurt him. I can remember my dad instantly so mad. And he called that mare a couple of names and said she knew exactly what she was doing. That ain't the first time she ever did that. And as he was releasing some anger, Thomas, Uncle Jay, was so brokenhearted. I mean, I can remember how upset he was. And Thomas is an old school man. I don't, you know what I'm saying? He's old, hard, tough. But I can remember he was so hurt because he let Dale got hurt pretty good. Messed him up for a little while. And Thomas was so upset. Immediately, he hauled that horse to the sale. So that was back when you could haul a horse to a sale barn and get rid of it. He run that horse in that sale ring, and that auctioneer, I had to call Thomas and get this right because I couldn't remember how it happened. I wasn't for sure. I called him this morning. I said, you need to remind me what we did. He said, we hauled him to the sale that night. Run him in there, and it come in that ring, and that auctioneer at Omo Horse Sales auctioneer would always say, anybody talking? Right? He said, anybody talking? Thomas stood up. He said, she's not to be PO'd. She's not to survive, and she's not to be bought by any individual. Sat right back down. Doug Milford bought that horse. Had her killed in Palestine the next day. Them horses was outlaws. That's all they's ever going to be. Come to find out, the guy that owned the black horse, that horse had done put people in the hospital. It done hurt grown men, and he wanted to put my brother on it. I mean, come to find out that gray mare had done the exact same thing to other people. That's why he got her at a pretty good price. But the man that sold her, he sure never mentioned that part. He dodged Thomas J. for a long time, I tell you that much. That is the person we're going to talk about today. The Nabals. They are bound and determined to do wicked things. They're bound and determined to inflict pain, heartache. They're angry. They may be like that paint, that black stud. I can remember later in life, we got a dun horse in that Daddy bought, and he told us, don't go in that pen with that horse. That sucker might be a little bit outlawish. And I remember asking him how he knew. You know, how do you know? He said, look at his eyes. He said, you got to do is look in his eyes. That sucker's got pig eyes. You don't need nothing to do with him. It took me forever to figure out what pig eyes was. I was talking to Martin. He said, Dale's Hunt used to always say, don't trust man nor horse with pig eyes. What the heck's pig eyes? They're narrow and they're close together. Don't even jack with them. You can't trust them. And the key is on a horse, if you can look in, if that horse has got kind eyes, big, kind eyes that you can look into, you can trust that horse. If you can't look into that horse's eyes, listen to me. If you can't look in a man's eyes, you just need to know something ain't right. If his eyes are close together, I'm telling you, that sir got pig eyes. That means they on the front. Better watch him. If you can't look in his eyes, my old man always told me, if a man won't look you in the eye, don't listen to his words. So we're going to find out about Nabal. We want to know how to identify him. By looking in their eyes. By using your eyes. In Psalms 14:1, listen, and exactly, almost word for word in Psalms 53:1, Scripture writes, the fool, the word fool there means Nabal, has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have committed abominable deeds. There is no one who does good. He has said it in his heart. Listen, he don't just think it. Thinking thoughts are momentary. Thinking thoughts are changed. You can change the way you think. When it's on your heart, it is truly what you believe. When something is written on your heart, it ain't going to change. That's truly how you believe. This is what Nabal, he really believes that there is no God. They not only say it, they live it. They are committed to do evil. They are committed to do wickedness. Psalm 74:18 says, remember how the enemy has mocked you. Remember that when I started this series, we talked about the simple, the unreasonable, the stubborn. Last week we talked about the mockers, and I said, I believe last week and this week, these people aren't just foolish and drifters. These people are wicked. They're in the same scripture right here. This scripture, Psalm 74:18, remember how the enemy has mocked you. That's the mockers that disrupt, that run their mouths, and they create damage with what they say. How foolish, that's the Nabals. People have spurned your name. They have not only hurt you, but they have just brought down the name of God. They have no empathy for you. That what that means is they don't have the ability to feel how you feel. They don't have the ability to give a flip. How do I say that? They don't give a rip how you are. They really don't. They really could care less how much how you feel, how you what your hurt is, what your needs. They don't care. They don't care. These people are very vain. And I asked Christy, I said, what's that word vain mean? So she looked it up and she read me two definitions. And I said, they both fit him. Number one, vain means a high, inflated self-image. When someone is vain, they sure think they are something. When I was a kid, we used to have a saying, you think you're hot snot on a gold platter, but you're really cold boogers on a paper plate. Where'd that come from? I mean, we used to say it. No. That's vain. That's vain. That's pretty cool, too. The other vain is when you do things in vain. Listen, this person, whatever efforts you put into them, in vain. Whatever money you invest, vain. Whatever time you spend, vain. Nothing. You get nothing for your efforts. That's the other side. Nabal is both of those. He thinks he is, and he ain't jack. And don't listen or benefit or improve from nothing you do. That's a Nabal. So you learn to identify them. It's really not that hard. It's really not. I mean, it's really, you can see them a mile off. Now you got to figure out, once we start recognizing them, what do you expect from them? You better expect something. You better expect pain, heartache, frustration, because they finna deal it out. Any chance they get, they finna give you some misery. Because they don't care how you feel. They feel good by what they do, regardless of the repercussions. What they gain, what they think. Isaiah 32:6 says, for the fool, there again, word, original word is Nabal. Isaiah 32:6. For the fool speaks folly in his mind, is busy with evil, he practices ungodliness and spreads error concerning the Lord. The hungry he leaves empty, and from the thirsty he withholds water. Listen, that original word where we translated it fool is Nabal. He speaks folly. So number one, this right here. The mouth is always working. The mind, his mind is busy. So not only is he talking about it, he's studying on it. You hear me? He's planning. He's scheming ways to be wicked and evil and for his own selfish gain. He's studying on how to do it better. You think that horse learned how to flip over like that overnight? She tried bucking. She tried several things. But when she figured out, shoot, I rear up a little bit, I'll take me about 6 steps forward on my back legs, I'll get enough weight over it. She fell. She had no control. When she started falling, whack! I've seen many horses fall over on her side. Them don't scare you. You let that happen once, you know how to come off that off shoulder and not get hurt at all. In fact, you can stand right over, and when they hit the ground, you can really kick them in the ear. But when one falls completely over and her head hits the ground just as hard as your head does, she has studied, and her whole intent in regard for her own being is to destroy you. She's studied on how to do this. So Nabal's study on how to be wicked and evil. They're busy with evil. He practices it. These people practice. Now listen, there's a whole difference in being a little wicked every now and then. And somebody what practices it. You know, when you practice something, the effort to practice is to perfect. It's the whole reason you practice anything is to perfect it. That band don't get up here and play like that. Just, wow! They practice. They practice so that when they do play, they have something invested in, and it's there. Nabal's practice being wicked. They practice being evil. They practice with folly. They practice with destruction. And he spreads error concerning the Lord. He lies. And he spreads it. He don't just lie when he needs to. He lies in order to. Y'all see the difference in that? And he has, this is where I back up, you better expect something from him. Because he leaves, the hungry he leaves empty. So that is what you can expect him not to do anything. But read the next part of that. And from the thirsty, he withholds water. So not only will he not do anything, he will make sure he don't do it. There's a big difference in, I know you're hungry, but I don't know how to get you full, or I'm not sure how to, or I got what you need, and I'll be dead gum if you're getting it. I know what would really be a blessing to you, but I would rather what you need, what I got. Does that make sense? Hey, they're real. They're real, and when you learn to expect that, you won't even waste your time with a Nabal. You'll roll on to Whataburger and order what you want. You can't get it your way with a Nabal. You'll never get it anyway with a Nabal. You just need to go. You know what he's going to do? He's going to put salt on it. He's going to put pepper on it. A little ketchup. And he's going to let it run down his chin. He's going to look at you. Get him another bite. That's what a Nabal does. many of us have been hurt very badly by this type of person. We have. Some of us had parents. I'm not saying I did. I was blessed. I've had parents that was this type of person. A lot of us have, and I'm not saying I have had spouses that's this type of person. Listen, I'm just going to call it like it is. That's the truth. Some people have been trained to be this. Some people, this is what they know. And the only way they know to get more or get better is to be better at it. So they study it, they practice it, they perfect it. If you learn not to expect nothing but that from them, you won't hang around them. Now, I'm all for let's change the world, let's love everybody. But I'm really all for all the sheeps not getting whooped by the wolves no more. I'm also learning to be all for teaching to be weary of sheeps in wolves' clothing. Because so many of our sheep in our church and in our homes and in our world, our country, have been sucked in and taken advantage of by the wolves because we never teach them. Pay attention. When you see this, kill it dead. Take it to the cell. And when somebody says anybody talking, stand up and tell the truth. I don't have no idea how much money Thomas lost on that horse. But I can tell you this much. You know what's still with him today? That's got to be at least 30 years ago. You know what's with him today? You know what he said today? That sucker never did it again. That's what sticks. That's what sticks. Here's what's wrong with our society. It is not popular to call someone out as a Nabal. It is not popular when somebody says, hey, would you, here's, when somebody says, can I put you down as a reference? I don't have a problem saying yeah. I don't even have to tell them, yeah, if you, I mean, sure. And I don't have a problem saying that sucker will not show up. Listen to me. This was supposed to be for my closing, but this is all over me to get this on off my chest. I wish my daddy to whoop that sucker buster what had that black horse. I wished I could have witnessed that whooping. I wish Thomas would have ever caught up with that man that lied, that sold that horse. The man never actually lied. He just withheld the truth. To me, that's a lying dog. Why don't you? Ooh, y'all got quiet. I tell you, the hardest thing in the world to do. Now, I ain't had to do this. I've been blessed. I've had to do it on the flip side. But we all got children, most of us, and they want to get married one of these days. You ever thought about you might have to look at the one what wants to marry them and say, let me tell you something about her. She's mine. He's mine. I love them. But you don't want to be hooked up with that. They will wear you out the rest of your life. Think about your jobs, people you deal with. Listen, church is the worst place. Now, let me tell you something. The first one what ought to be tagged what he is a pastor. If I leave this church and I leave this church ripped or if I left this church damaged or if I got selfish and greedy and I took all I could from this church or I was a shame on you. If when somebody calls and says, hey, we need a reference for Pastor Jason Taylor, if you don't say that sucker will eat you alive. Shame on you. If you don't say, you know what, he looks good, he sounds good, he might preach and make you laugh, but in the end, churches don't do that. They're so happy that sucker finally left, they don't care where he goes. They just say, oh, hallelujah. We need to do the same thing for our church. If this church don't love people, any and every person that walks through that door, we need to go, we got a problem here. We need to tell the truth. If we just tell the truth for what it is and how it is and who it is, the truth will work itself out. It's hard to do that. It ain't got nothing to do with this message. So you got to learn what to expect from them. And expect him to be wicked and evil and mean. Expect him to be hateful, hurtful. How do you respond? Avoid him. Listen to me. In all my years, even after we quit training and riding horses and we was in the trucking business, when we was, no matter what we was in, I heard my daddy say twice, no, we ain't going to do that. I mean, I'm telling you, he didn't believe that you couldn't handle it. He didn't. It was not in him. He didn't understand that might hurt. He didn't. He knew it hurt. He didn't care if it hurt. It'll only make you stronger. Gone. But I mean, so avoid when you see them, when you identify them, avoid them. I wish I could give you a great answer, but you can't change them. You can't fix them. You need to avoid them. You need to have nothing to do with them. Turn them over to God. Just get clear of the whole situation because it's going to get ugly and worse before it ever gets better. Now, if you're married to one, I did not say divorce them. I'm learning and God's showing me that you can be married to a Nabal, someone committed and convinced to do evil, and you can turn them over to God and allow him to discipline and do with them as he pleases, and you never have to leave the house. Now, I'm learning this. I've never had to experience it, but you can literally lay them at the feet of Jesus and the throne of God and say, I'm done. I will not divorce them. I will not go against what the Scriptures tell me to do. I will not abandon. I will not abuse or neglect, but I will more than gladly say, oh, here you go, Lord. Take them. You know, Paul taught us how to do that in 1 Corinthians 5. 1 Corinthians 5:5. I should have got my glasses out. Paul was talking to the church of Corinth and talking about sin, and this was a bad sin that this person was in, and it was horrible. And Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 5:5, I have decided to deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. You have to make it. Paul decided to just turn them over, to let Satan have his way. There's times in your life you're going to have to say, you know what? I'm turning you over. And I pray you get on down that road and you go real fast and you hit real hard. And if there's any pieces left, we'll gladly watch the Lord put it back together. But if there ain't nothing left, hallelujah, get it on with now. Get on and get out. There are places and times when that harsh and painful of love must be done. But there's nothing else that can be done with a Nabal. You cannot fix them. You may think you can. You will spend countless years of your life in frustrations, and you will either pull your hair out or your hair will turn gray because you want to, but you can't do nothing with them. Turn them over to the Lord. Let God have them, and let God do what he wants with them. If you read Romans 8:26-28. In the same way that the Spirit also gives help to our weaknesses. For we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes with us, groans. I jumped way ahead. I wasn't supposed to read that yet. Scratch that. We'll come back. I studied on trying to have y'all give y'all an example of how to deal with these people. Because here's the thing. You either live with one or you will encounter them. You come across them in business, in life, in general. Maybe it's the guy that you see every morning at the coffee shop. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I can't talk today. You run into them, and I want to show you what to do with them. I'm gonna be real quick, and I'm gonna go through a story. But listen, you need to read this whole story. It's 1 Samuel chapter 25. You need to read all of verse 25 in order for you to really get it. I'm just going to run you through the story. And verse 2 says, now there was a man in Moan whose business was in Carmel, and the man was very rich, and he had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and it came about while he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the man's name was Nabal. Hey, when you do that original word search for what Nabal meant, when somebody's name was Nabal, it meant the same thing as the way we translated fool. Nabal was a fool. And his wife's name was Abigail. And the woman was intelligent and beautiful in appearance. But the man was harsh and evil in his dealings, and he was a Calebite. All right? two things right there. Nabal was his name. That's what he was called. Now, I'm just going to have to gamble on this, but I bet his parents didn't give him that name when he come out of the womb. Who would name their kid that? I mean, that name meant, I am a wicked fool. I am a wicked man of folly, man of destruction. So they, I think, as he grew up, they scratched their head, and they distanced themselves from him, and they just said, that sucker's a Nabal. He is a Nabal. They cut all ties with him. And he married Abigail. Back in those days, they didn't get to pick their spouse. They didn't court and date, and they were appointed. He was very wealthy. So poor Abigail, I would just gamble. I ain't dug on this, but I just am gambling that poor Abigail pretty much got told by her folks, you're marrying Nabal. And they probably got a pretty good piece of stuff for Abigail. There probably was a little transaction that took place, right? Do y'all know that marriage is the image of God's entering a relationship with each one of us? Do you agree with me in that? Do you realize that when we marry, when God marries into us, when that happens, we ask Jesus to be our Lord, there's a ceremony and a covenant that takes place. And when we follow through with baptism of water and His presence and power of surrendering our lives over, then he brings sins to us the Holy Spirit, who is very beautiful, extremely intelligent. His name's Wisdom, matter of fact. I want you to stay with me. I'm gonna do my best to be quick. But when God shows me something that I'm like, woo, I just get hung up sometimes. So I'm going to try my best to be quick. But do you know that you ain't very pretty? And that you, in the flesh, are sin. And what else did they say about Nabal? He was harsh. Do you know how harsh you are? In the flesh, in who you are, the best day that you can be, you're a harsh individual. But as you become a Christian, you get married into the Holy Spirit. And the Scripture says the two shall leave and cleave and become one. You shall become one in your marriage to the Holy Spirit. All right, Abigail finds herself stuck in this marriage to a man that she really is sickened by, I would just have to guess. I tell you something, I just have to guess. I know in my own life, I like to preach to me because I can't get too offended at me. But I know I sicken the Holy Spirit that I'm married to at times. And I know the Holy Spirit scratches his head and wonders, wow, Lord, I would have never chose Jason. I'd have never chose to be yoked to Jason Taylor for the rest of our lives. And our Lord says, yeah, but I chose him. And you stay married. So the Holy Spirit don't leave me. He may get frustrated with me. But now watch. David has been tending to this man and taking care of this man's stuff out in the mountain. Now, David's on the run from Saul, and David's got an army of mighty men that do whatever David says. He's the leader. He's the leader of many, many men, and they do whatever he tells them. And he says, you protect this flock. Nothing has harmed, nothing has been lost. This man's, all of his stuff is profited because David watched out for him. Now, David didn't know him. He just knew we need to take care of him. We're going to take care of him. We're going to watch him. Now they're at the harvest time. They're shearing. This guy's rolling in the dough. And David sends 10 guys to go and seek some provisions. You know what? We've invested. We poured into this deal. We took care of him. We guarded him. We protected him. He won't mind helping us a little bit. After all, everything could have been lost several times, and we kept him from losing it. Hello, Holy Spirit keeps you from losing everything many times because you don't deserve nothing. You deserve the penalty of sin, which we all know in Scripture says is death. But you don't get that, do you? Why? Because the Holy Spirit is interceding for you. David has been placed to protect him, to guard him. And this guy, look what happens. Look what happens. In I'm going to get there. Verse 9 and 10. Verse chapter 25, verse 9 and 10. When David's young men came, they spoke to Nabal according to all these words in David's name. Then they waited. But Nabal answered David's servants and said, who is David? Who is this son of Jesse There are many servants today, and each of them are breaking away from his master. Shall I then take my bread and my water and my meat that I have slaughtered from my shearers and give to the men whose origin I do not know? Let me just tell you something about a Nabal. Everybody is a nobody to a Nabal. Don't get your feelings hurt. You need to expect that. Don't wonder why he treats you like that. He treats everybody like that. Ain't nobody, and everybody's a nobody to a Nabal because they're all about themselves. That's all they care about. All right, look at verse 18 and 19. This is what I like. I'm going to back you up to verse 17 real quick. Now, therefore, now, all these guys go back to King David, and they tell him exactly what happened. You think he didn't get hot? He's mad. He's mad all over. I tell you, heads up, ain't nobody make you mad like a Nabal can make you mad. You'd be like, woo. So anyway, he's mad. He's mad all over. Verse 17 says, now therefore, know and consider what you should do. This young man of Nabal that works for Nabal goes to his wife and says, hey, I want you to know this. This son of guns run him off. And the scripture actually says he is a worthless man. And I didn't go talk to Nabal. I came and talked to you, Abigail, because he's worthless. It does me no good to go talk to him. Abigail, you do what you should do. Abigail, go and do what you think. Abigail gathers up everything she thinks David might need, and she leaves to go meet him in the mountains. And there again, Abigail says, but I'm not telling Nabal. There's no need for me to tell Nabal what I'm doing. He'll just train wreck it. That's what he likes to do. He will figure out some way to make the wheels come off. So I'm just going to go do what we should have done in the first place. I'm going to go thank David for protecting us and providing for us what we needed. But I'm going to leave Nabal out of it because Nabal's a fool. Listen to me. When you really want to worship our Lord, leave your flesh at the house. Leave you and all that you've ever been at the door and allow the Spirit to worship Him. The Spirit that is within you that He has yoked with you knows how to worship. Knows how to praise Him. But how many times do you, when you really want to do this, or you really want to sing, you check with Nabal. Oh, I ain't going to do that. Folks be watching me. So you end up sitting back down. There's somebody in here that can interpret that for you. I'm not him yet. Check Nabal at the gate, man. Have I read 19? She said to the young man, go on before me. That don't matter. All right, I didn't read it, but I summarized it up. Abigail gathered everything she needed and took off. Verse 21 and 22, now David had said, surely in vain. What did I tell you about Nabal's? It's everything you do will be in vain. David says, surely in vain I have guarded all that this man has in the wilderness so that nothing has been missed that belonged to him, and he has returned me evil for good. When you deal with a Nabal, you will always get the opposite of what you give. You will always get evil. You can do good all you want, you're going to get evil in return. Expect that. If you want to give all your good and get all his evil, misery will be your house. I don't know. I'm not going there with you no more. I don't want that. I want that sucker to be miserable by himself. I don't want to give up the good that I have. Listen to me. When you mingling Abigail with Nabal, Lord, help me. I'm getting confused. There's so much of a truth right there that I can't get unwrapped yet that would set us all free about the marrying of our spirit, God's spirit in us with us. Let me keep rolling. I'm really sorry. I know y'all are frustrated with me right now. Hang in there. In both those horse stories I shared, to me, the horse was just what it was. The real sorry scoundrel was the guy that was involved, the man that knew but wouldn't share, the man that withheld, or the man that wanted to see. He didn't care if Dale got hurt. He didn't care if I got hurt. He didn't care. He just wanted to get rid of something, or he just wanted to see if we might be the ones that could get it done so he could benefit. That's the Nabals. That's what Nabals always do. Verse 24 and 25, as Abigail approaches David, and David's hot. I mean, David literally says to her, if there's one male being alive in the that has anything to do with Nabal by morning, should it all come on me? He's like, I'm going to wipe them out. But Abigail, she falls on her feet. She fell at his feet and said, On me alone, my Lord, be the blame. Please let your maidservant speak to you and listen to the words that your maidservant. Please do not let my Lord pay attention to this worthless man, Nabal. As for his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I, your maidservant, did not see the young men and my Lord whom you sent. Abigail is interceding for Nabal. She rushes to David and says, please, please, don't pay no attention to that foolish man. His name says who he is. All right, back to my scripture in Romans. And you don't have to flip there. Go there and learn it. The Holy Spirit intercedes on your behalf because you are a foolish being in the flesh. We don't get it. In the flesh, who I am by nature is a Nabal. I am losing y'all. Gosh. Maybe I'm losing me. You remember we're marrying, okay? You're married to the Holy Spirit that God sent. You didn't deserve that bride. You way out kicked your punt coverage. I mean, the Holy Spirit is beautiful and intelligent, and you're ruthless and dumb and slothful and lazy and selfish. I'm gonna tell you something. Kids don't have to be taught to say mine. They come out going mine. That we are selfish beings by nature. This is what the picture of the Holy Spirit does for you. The Holy Spirit does not sit back and watch you take a beating. The Holy Spirit runs ahead of you and says, put it on me. Put his ignorance on me. Listen to what happens. Listen to what happens. Gosh almighty, I want to get this out so bad. So David listens to her. And he don't go on and wipe them out. Verse 28 says, please forgive the transgressions of your maidservant, for the Lord will certainly make for my Lord an enduring house, because my Lord is fighting battles of the, I ain't where I need to be, of the Lord, and evil will not be found in all your days. Drop all the way down to 35, I think. So David received from her hand what she had brought him, and said to her, go up to your house in peace. See that I have listened to you and granted your request. That's what the Lord will do. That's what the throne of God does for us when the Holy Spirit intercedes on our behalf, because we're so stupid sometimes. We're so blessed. Listen, you don't like the Holy Spirit because you don't really know what he does. You're afraid of the Holy Spirit because you've never really seen who he really is for you. He loves you so much that in spite of your wickedness or your sin and your desires of the flesh and your prideful eye and your haughtiness and your whatever it is that is really who you are, he goes to the throne on your behalf and pleads and says, no, put that on me. I will take it. I will take it. And he lets the Holy Spirit comes back. And within the Holy Spirit is the ability to have peace. But we as Nabals, we don't engage. We don't want to become one. So watch what happens. Abigail came to Nabal. And behold, he was holding a feast in his house, like the feast of a king, and Nabal's heart was merry within him, for he was very drunk. Do you know that what the word drunk means in the Bible? It means drunk. He was very drunk. Okay? He was drunk. I love her response. This is some. Hey, listen. If you don't learn nothing else today, learn this, because he was drunk. Say it with me one time. Nabal was very drunk. All right. We know the condition he was in. Most of us have been there numerous times. So she did not tell him anything. Listen, it don't do no good to talk to a drunk. You're wasting your breath. She went on to bed, and look what she does. Look what she does. But in the morning, when the wine had gone out of Nabal, his wife told him these things. So she waited till he was hungover. I love it. That sucker got that old, he's on that dog, you know. His head's going doo, doo, doo. He don't even know who. He don't even know what all he said or did. He can't find none of his clothes. And she says, "Oh, by the way, I went and seen David, and I stopped him from bringing the 400 men down here and killing yourself and slaughtering you and taking all your stuff. That man was coming to get you." She told him everything while he was hungover and miserable. She didn't baby him and give him no Tylenol. "You feel better in the morning?" "No, feel bad. I bet that sucker was going, "Broo!" And she'd wait. "And also," he said, She didn't coddle him. She told him the truth. Look what happened. "And his heart died within him so that he became like stone." Remember where in the beginning I said Nabal's folly was written on his heart, not his thoughts, right? It's written on his heart. But let me tell you something. I believe this with all my heart. I believe. That's the song. I believe finally by faith because I don't understand it. And I believe finally God will do it. I don't have to. The Nabals that I encounter, I will just surrender them to him. I will just allow them to be and do what they do, and I will just tell them the truth. Not when they're drunk, not when they're mad, but when they're hungover, when they're suffering, possibly when they're bankrupt. You go, No, I don't have no cash for you, but I do know this. I believe, here's what I believe. Look what happens. Verse 39, I'm wrapping up. Brian, y'all come back. I don't know how to end this because I done got way in deep water. Y'all ever been there when you're swimming? And you're in deeper water, and you know how to get out of, and you can't find the banks, and no muddy. That's where I'm at. So y'all just bear with me. I've been there a while this week, right here. But I really want you to get this, please. I know, please turn your minds back on for just a couple of seconds, and try to get this, because this is good stuff. This is way better than I'm preaching. This is good stuff. Verse 38, we talked about where he became like stone. It was verse 37. Verse 38, about 10 days later, the Lord struck Nabal, and he died. Verse 39, when David heard Nabal was gone, he said, "Blessed be the Lord who has pleaded the cause of my reproach from the hand of Nabal and has kept back his servant from evil. The Lord has also returned the evil doing of Nabal on his own head." Then David sent a proposal to Abigail to take her as his wife. Do you know what the Lord Jesus is going to do? He's going to come back and get his bride. But listen, we don't have to wait for the rapture. Listen to me. If we will surrender the Nabal that the Holy Spirit had to marry when the God Almighty said, "Hey, he just accepted my son. I want my Holy Spirit in him. We're going to be married to him." And even though the Holy Spirit didn't choose you, and he got with you and he went, "What have you put me? Why have you yoked me with such a Nabal?" And I can just hear him talking. Can't y'all? I can hear the Holy Spirit going, "God, yes, Holy Spirit. This sucker's ruthless and ignorant. He don't shower. Why would you send me to him?" And the Holy Spirit says, "Because my son died for him. You're married to him. Now love him. Love him, love him, love him." And the whole time the Holy Spirit's interceding for us in our foolishness. He's going to the throne. "Lord, don't give them what they deserve. Please be patient with them. They'll come around. One day I pray that Abigail, the Holy Spirit, has the opportunity when you're sober, hungover, broke, sick, and disgusted with who you are, to speak to you the truth of who you really are and what the Holy Spirit has done for you all these years. You will die in here. You will immediately, the flesh will become cold. You will not like you. You will not want to be like you ever again. You will want to be different to the degree you will do whatever it takes that you not be like you've always been. Then, and only then, do you really encounter the marriage of the Holy Spirit that you've been blessed to get. Then and only then do you realize I am trading up. I'm getting rid of a Nabal and I'm getting a king. Then and only then. I believe we all can have that marriage. I believe he wants every one of us to experience that kind of life. I believe he wants every Nabal, every part of the ignorant flesh that we drag around, whatever it is that's in you, that's left, that you can't cut away and you can't seem to stop thinking about, whatever it is, I don't know. Whoever it is, if you're married to them, if you're in business with them, if you're, I don't know. If you give birth to them, cut them loose. Cut them loose for their own good. So that whenever they get to the bottom of who they are, might possibly save their souls from eternal hell. Cut them loose. Don't coddle them suckers to the depths of hell. Cut them loose and let them suffer in the pain and the agony. Let them sober up and get hung over, sick and rolling in their own puke. Then tell them what's really happened for them. Then let the Holy Spirit trust them. Man, I'm so glad I was young enough that I didn't go. My dad, I told y'all this 3 weeks ago. My dad said, I thought it'd cost you a whole lot more and you'd stay a whole lot longer. I'm just glad you woke up when you did. Man, I can you imagine what the Holy Spirit would say if each and every one of us would just wake up, sober up, and go, I do not like what's in here. I don't want to be this in here. I want Abigail to be greater and Nabal to be less. I want to be more beautiful and more wiser. I believe it can happen. I believe he wants to do it for every one of us that have asked Jesus Christ to be our Lord and Savior. I believe without a doubt. I am living proof that without a doubt. He will wait on you. He will intercede for you. He pleads for you constantly. He is always approaching the throne. No, 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 no. Put it on me, Lord. No, 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 no. No, 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 don't let that happen to him yet. Put it on me, Lord. Put it on me, Lord. He's constantly doing it for that. I believe one day you will open up your eyes that's in here and you will see what truly has been done for you and how much the Holy Spirit truly loves you, and you will welcome him. You will accept and receive him for who he really is. The greatest gift you've ever been given. The greatest blessing. Now listen, I'm not talking about comparing him to salvation through the blood of Jesus. I'm talking about living on this earth. Nothing gets better than living and walking with intimacy with the Holy Spirit. He was given to you, and he's way better than we deserve.